Don't you think we should give glory to this man? You deserve the glory. This morning, that each and every one of us will lift our hearts to your throne of grace. Amen. And that the word which we are about to hear will benefit us,
Amen.
Would richly affect our decisions.
Amen.
We ask God Almighty that every form of distraction, every form of restlessness, every spirit that puts the body of a man in a place, and his mind somewhere else, we come against this morning.
Amen.
Lord, I pray that your children will hear you.
Amen.
And through your word, their lives will be changed.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you,
in Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
God bless you. As we continue with our series, Hard Choices, I want to quickly iterate again that you can only make a choice when you have options. For instance, if you have only one pair of shoes, all you can do is to clean it and wear it You can't make a choice because you don't have a choice. We have also discovered that the more choices you have, the more complicated your life becomes. I know that some people were late today to church, not because they didn't have what to wear, but they had too many options. And they couldn't make up their mind which one it would be, because they all look pretty. If you have only one shirt, all you need to do is to wash it and wear it. It's easy. So the more you have, the more options you have, the more complicated your life becomes. It is possible for an option to be complicated, but not hard. Amen?
Amen.
It is possible for an option to be complicated, but not a hard choice. For instance, if you have so many beautiful dresses, like I said earlier, you can't go wrong. It's not really a hard choice, it's just a complicated choice. So when does the choice become hard? When are we confronted with hard choices? A choice becomes hard when you are required to choose what you less prefer. You see, when you have so many options, you will have to pick one. And if the options you have, you prefer them equally, it's just a matter of time trying to decide which one. Whichever one you decide is fine, because they are all, you feel the same way towards them. But in the hierarchy of your options in life, there are some you prefer. There are some you less prefer. There are some you don't even want to touch at all. They are so far away from your preference. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Now, an option becomes hard when the situation in your life compels you to pick something that you less prefer. Are you with me? As we continue in this series, we said we're going to look at these hard choices in three areas: in our relationships, in our service to God, and in our giving. Today I'm going to stick with our hard choices, or the hard choices we make in our relationships. And I'm going to make some categorical statements. Sometimes I call them absolute statements. But they're true. Their facts may not be applicable in every case, but in most cases they are. So I'm going to say that for two people to have a good relationship, each must be prepared to make some hard choices. For two people that come together, you see, whenever two human beings come together, and they want to have a relationship, it could be ordinary friendship, it could be marriage, it could be whatever. Any relationship takes away from who you are as a person. It takes away some of your individuality. You have to give up something to be in the relationship. And for that relationship to be good, you have to occasionally pick or choose to do the things that you less prefer so that you can maintain that relationship. Amen? Does that make sense? The unfortunate thing is that doing what you less prefer can sometimes be very discomforting. Particularly if you have to do it more often than the person you are in a relationship with. Doing less than what you prefer, or doing what you less prefer, in some quarters can be actually called suffering. Maybe that was what God was saying. In the Bible, when he said in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, he said, "Yes, and all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution." Maybe what God was saying at that time, sign is that if you want to have a relationship with me, you want to have a good relationship with me, you'll be forced by our relationship to do some of the things that you less prefer. And those things that you less prefer sometimes may result in you suffering. You chose to be holy, so you declared your taxes right. You end up paying so much that you can hardly eat, but you chose to suffer for a principle that you believe in. There's nobody that pays high taxes that prefers to pay it. It's not their first choice, it's not our preference. But we do it because sometimes there's something bigger than us that compels us to do less of what we prefer. And that is why in your relationship with Christ, if you are truly entangled with Jesus Christ and you are directed by his words, there are times that you will have to what?
Suffer.
I can't hear you.
Suffer.
Don't be afraid to say it.
Suffer.
Suffer. He says it. All who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will, not may, will suffer. Also, when two people come into a relationship, when two people start a relationship, the further apart their thinkings are, the more they each individually have to suffer. Maybe I need to explain that. If I start a relationship with Brother Bayo, and our thinking is somewhat alike, the adjustment we have to both do is minimal, right? But if I start a relationship with somebody whose mindset is so way, way far from me, I want to come to church on a Sunday, he says, no, if you want to maintain my friendship, we have to go to the golf club this morning. And he insists that if you don't go to the golf club with me, we're not friends. You don't like me. Our thinkings are so far apart, and because we want to maintain that relationship, what happens? Most of us will have to do a lot less of what we prefer to maintain the relationship. And that would be what? A lot of suffering. Are you with me? And maybe that was why God said in Isaiah 55 verse 8. He said, your ways are so far from me. He says, Isaiah 55 verse 8, he says, my thoughts are your thoughts, are not your thoughts. He says, no, your ways are my ways, says the Lord. We are so far apart. But yet those who are committed to a relationship with Jesus Christ find a way to keep doing what they less prefer until what they less prefer becomes a habit. Are you following me?
Yes.
Listen to me, church. Nobody started ultimately desiring to be good. The heart of man is wicked and desperately wicked too. Our hearts are evil and desperately wicked. The natural man does not like the things of God. When you see a man that starts to like the things of God, it's because he has what? Practiced. He has grown in habits. He has suffered consistently trying to do what he less prefers until what he less prefers starts to become what he prefers. When God was going to call the man called Saul, you call him Paul now because he's done with. Good. But when he started off as Saul, when God was going to call Saul in the book of Acts chapter 9, he called a very damaged man. A man that had his way so far from him. Far, far, far from him. And when in verse 15, God said, I have chosen him, Acts chapter 9, verse 15, he said, I have chosen him, he told Ananias that. And he told Ananias to go and tell him in verse 16 that there are things that he must suffer. He said, for I will show him many things he must what? Suffer for my name's sake. Why would God call you and show you the things you must suffer? Why? Because your ways are so far from his ways. And as you reshape yourself, as you remodel yourself, as you reconstruct yourself to align with Christ or with the things of God, it's painful. Very painful. It's a surgery without anesthesia. That was what her mother did. We come up with things that will explain to boost our ego that we don't really lose. We spend so much time packaging stories to make us feel better and to make her feel bad. We tell tales to pull her down. Church, I can tell you that maybe Joseph really wanted to say terrible things about Mary. Maybe that was what he preferred to do, but he didn't. He chose to make the hard choice. He chose to make the hard choice. I want to tell you this morning, if you are here and you have been hurt, don't be in a hurry to wash your dirty linen in public. We must be careful what we say about the people we love. We must protect them even when we're in pain. Guys, when you tell your sister how terrible your wife is, the day you forgive your sister, your wife, your sister will not forgive her.
That's right.
It's the truth.
That's true.
When you say too much, particularly men by nature are easy to forgive. Tell a woman something, she has it in her left hand for 15 years. Protect the honor of your spouse. Ladies, when you tell your husband, your friends, when he's not there, that man is a useless man, your friends will treat him like a useless man. Even when you want to return honor to him, they will not honor him. Protect the interest. It is not what we prefer to do. And that's my point this morning. It is not what we prefer to do. I'm sure it was not what Joseph preferred to do that day, but he chose to take the hard choice. When couples come to me for counseling, and they always fight me for this, but I'm not interested in hearing what happened yesterday. I don't care to know what happened 1 year ago, 2 years ago. There's a perfect. I say I don't want to hear. The only thing I want you to do is to listen to me. I will give you pills, the antibiotics. Take them twice a day, and the healing process will start. I don't care about what caused this ulcer. I don't care about what caused the pain. I don't care, because by telling me what caused the pain, you are reopening the wound. I know you want to tell me she's horrible. I know you want to tell me he's horrible. Yes, I know, but I don't care about that, and you shouldn't be that. No matter what it is, what you are going through with your spouse, when somebody else outside your family comes to you, tell them it is well. Because one day it will be well, and you will not be able to withdraw what you have released. It will be too late. Joseph chose to protect Mary. He chose to. It's hard not to work, not to retaliate. That's why it's the hard choice. But that's the choice you must make, because that's the choice the Bible tells us to take. The Bible says in Romans chapter 12, verse 21, says, do not overcome. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Church, I want to tell you this. If there was somebody that treated David badly, it was Saul. Saul treated David horribly. But along the line, David protected that relationship with his life. When David was told that Jonathan and Saul were dead, you know what he said in 1 Samuel chapter 1 verse 20, I believe? He said, tell it not in God. Publish it not, ask the Lord. Let the daughters of the Philistines rejoice. Let the daughters of the sacrifice triumph. He told them, don't talk about these horrible, glorious people like that. They were not glorious to me. But he chose to maintain their honor, which is what they are supposed to do in relationship. He did not stop there. Let's read from verse 23. He says, Saul and Jonathan were beloved and pleasant in their lives. And in their death, they were not divided. They were swifter than eagles. They were stronger than lions. O daughters of Israel, weep over Saul, who clothed you in scarlet with luxury, who put ornaments of gold on your upper. That is what he chose to see. No matter what is going on in your relationship, don't wash your dirty linen anymore. Keep it, because it's about to change. It's a hard choice, but that's what good men do. That's what good women do. They protect the integrity of the people they are in relationship with, even when it makes them look bad. You know, sometimes you have protected the person you are with. Everybody says you are the one that is wrong. That's okay. Heaven knows the truth. But you are a person of integrity. It's a hard choice. But it's a choice you must make in a relationship. What's the second thing that Joseph did? Matthew chapter 1, verse 28. The Bible says that, but while he thought about these things, and that tells me that Joseph stopped from acting. And I want you to note this, so I don't forget. Note this. What was the first thing he did? He protected the integrity of his relationship. He did not think to do that. Hello? That one came naturally to him. It was after he had protected that he now said, okay, what do I do now? Do I send her away? Do I kill her? Do I marry her? He now sat down. The first thing a man of integrity will do is protect. And that's why sometimes when you say things about men of God that knows God, no matter what you say about them, they just say it as well. They don't defend themselves. They let God do that. And in verse 128, he said, but while he thought about it, so the next thing he did was that he gave the situation a deep thought. He gave the situation a good thought. When we are angry, when we think that our decision is easy, maybe if we sit down and think about it, the same decision that we think is an easy decision may not be the right decision. We should give ourselves time to think. We should take counsel from people before we make our choices. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 9, verse 9, it says, give instructions to a wise man and he will be wiser. Teach a just man like Joseph and he will increase in learning. If you take time to think deeply, church, you may discover that what you prefer to do is not the right thing. Can you imagine? Can you imagine that years later, Joseph married somebody else and now discovered that Mary did not play around, that it was truly the Holy Spirit. Years later, he now discovered that he would have been the father of God himself. And many of us have made mistakes because we did not what? Sit down to think about it. I was talking to a woman many years ago. She told me, she's not in this church anymore. But she was in the church. She said, Pastor, if I had met you when I met you, I probably would not have divorced my first husband. She said that and said to me, because I have found out now, many years of marrying again, that they are all the same. You know why they are not the same? Let me tell you why they are not the same. That's what I told her. If you have spent 15 years trying to change somebody, and they have changed just a little, you are better off than starting from zero again.
Mm-hmm.
Because by the time you get to 15 years later, they will still just have changed. Are you here this morning? Are you about to make a decision about your relationship? Think a little longer, I beg you. Take some time. Don't be in a hurry. It's a hard choice. But it's the right choice. Finally, what did Joseph do? Let us read verse 20 to 23. What did he do? But while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. As he was thinking about this thing, God came to him in a dream. And the Lord gave him an instruction about the boy that was about to be born, about what he had to do. Let's skip to verse 24. After all these things happened, the Bible says, then Joseph being aroused from his sleep, God came and gave him instruction. And Joseph did something. He was open to the leading of God. What do I say? He was open to the leading of God. When the angel came to him, he was sleeping. And I can tell you that there's so many of us here this morning. You are enjoying this sermon. It is ministering to you. You think that you can go home and make do what less what you less prefer. But as you step out of there, something will come over you and say, oh, that's for them. They don't even know my own story. My story is worse. The Bible says that Joseph was in a dream, but in verse 24, when he was aroused from the sleep, he woke up. He stepped out of church. He got into his car. The Bible says, when Joseph was aroused from his sleep, what did he do? Did as the angel of the Lord commanded. He subjected himself to the leading of the Lord. Most of us wake up and say, oh, that was a nightmare. Thank God. It was a nightmare. For me to take that woman back, thank God. Then you lead out and pray. You are thanking God that it was a dream, but when Joseph woke up, he did what the Lord led him to do. And you're here this morning about to make a wrong decision. Let the Lord lead you. Don't think that this is a dream or arranged or anything. No, there is a word for somebody here this morning. If you will listen, 10 years from now, you will not regret it. If you will listen, it may seem to you a hard choice. It may seem to you a less preferred choice. It may seem to you an unreasonable choice. But if you will listen, if you allow God to lead you, things will be different for you. Your story will be different. Amen?
Amen.
Finally, as I close, and I'm not just going to summarize this because we don't have time. God wanted to show us also that he makes hard choices concerning you and I. That was a man making a hard choice. But God himself makes hard choices every time. So he, and you need to go home and read the book of Hosea. The book of Hosea tells us about how God took the prophet just to show him how we, as the children of God, prostitute ourselves constantly. He told the prophet to go and marry a prostitute. And the prostitute gave back to 3 children and then still went out to go and have other men. And God said, go back and take her. And God was showing us that that is what he does every time you mess up. That's what he does every time. It doesn't left to God. I'm telling you, God is loving, but also is a flame of fire. Left to God, sometimes he wants to whip you. That may be his first choice, but he does what he less prefer. He loves you anyway. The Bible says in Hosea chapter 2, verse 19 and 20, we just read that and we close. He says, I will breathe or I will betroth you to me forever. Yes, I will betroth you to me in righteousness and justice, in loving kindness and mercy. I will betroth you to me in faithfulness, and you shall know the Lord. That is the nature of God. He makes the hard choices concerning us every day. And that is what he wants us to do. We must, church, learn to do what we less prefer. We must learn to do what we less prefer. It may be difficult, but it is what God requires of us in our relationships. Let us bow our heads. It is what God requires of us in our relationships. And it's what I'm going to require of you this morning if you are here in this sanctuary. And you don't have a relationship, a true relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ. I know you prefer to sit down there and just let the time pass by. But I want you to do the hard stuff. I want you to make the hard choice this morning. I know, yes, it could be embarrassing to put up your hands, but it's not. We all did it at some stage. It may not be what you prefer, but it's what you have to do. If you're here this morning and you want to have a relationship with Jesus, you want to submit your heart unto him, wave your hand at me and I'll pray with you. It's a hard choice, but it's a choice we all make. Oh yes, as you make that choice, you are going to do what you less prefer. It may look like suffering initially, but I don't end up in a better place. Are you here this morning? And you want to make that decision for Jesus? Wave your hands at me, I want to pray with you. We always want to end the service doing this. We always want to call you to the glory and the knowledge of God. Are you here this morning? You want to choose to commit your life unto Jesus. Wave your hands at me and I'll pray with you. Is there anyone this morning? Is there anyone this morning? I'm waiting for you. Let's give glory to God. I want us to begin to pray for ourselves. And if you are here this morning, and you know that you are in the valley of decision, you know that you have been struggling to do what you less prefer, I want to ask God for that grace, that you make the right decision. I want to ask God for that grace. If you have started a process and you want to turn back, go ahead and turn back. If you have said words that are unkind and you want to repent, go ahead and repent. If you have separated yourself from people on a permanent basis and you know that you can restitute, go and do it. But you must ask for grace because it takes a special grace to do this. The Bible says that when Joseph was aroused from sleep, he did according to the instructions of the angel. As you live here today, ask that God will make it possible for you to do according to what you have decided to do in the course of this service. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that as many that are praying concerning this situation, you will assist them. You will encourage them. You will ensure that they fulfill and complete what they have imagined in their hearts. As they have been aroused from sleep, they will pursue that which they are determined to do. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. One of their birthdays, the other one will express love. So we have three today. Whose birthday is it? Yours. Whose birthday is it? Yours.